So, Pastor Lopez, you just got your PhD in interdisciplinary studies. It has some emphasis in there. What are the particular emphases of your interdisciplinary
ministry and leadership and biblical studies? Okay. And the interdisciplinary approach allowed me to combine these three disciplines, which I'm very passionate about all three. And I'm very thankful that the school I attended, Ambridge University, allowed me to craft a dissertation that really incorporated those three in a substantive way. It wasn't cursory. It was very, each of them played an integral role in the formation of my dissertation.
Fantastic. So the title, and I can see it here, the United Pentecostal Church International and Single Elder Congregationalism. Would you mind giving us a little overview of, first, how you came to this subject, what interested you in this subject initially, perhaps your inspiration for it, and then a concise synopsis of your findings?
Sure. Well, you know, I'm in a very unique role. I've been in ministry for many years now. When I was 20 years old, in between my sophomore and junior year, Kenneth Haney hired me to join his church staff here at Christian Life Center in Stockton. And from that time till now, almost 30 years, I've been involved in ministry. After I graduated from college, I became a full-time member of the pastoral staff. So I've been involved in ministry for many years, but I've never been a senior pastor. And so I have a little bit of an outside perspective to the role of the senior pastor. And sometimes, you know, that can be a good thing, because with that outside perspective, you're able to consider things and contemplate things. And I've worked with great senior pastors, Kenneth Haney and Nathaniel Haney. I have many friends in ministry who are senior pastors that I really admire and respect. But I got to realizing that in the United Pentecostal Church, we've never really examined why we do some of the things that we do. And one of those areas is ecclesiology, the functions of the church, the practices of the church. And I've reached out to, you know, different leaders. Why do we do it this way? I even reached out to our general superintendent, Dr. David Bernard, you know, some email exchanges back and forth. And a lot of our ecclesial practices we inherited from other faith traditions, because, you know, Pentecost coming out of, you know, the Wesleyan Methodist movement, the holiness movements, we ended up incorporating a lot of things that were just handed down as our predecessors were, you know, coming out. And you know, that was a word, you know, the whole coming out movement, the whole coming out of these dead, dry, denominal, you know, movements. Mm-hmm. And then Pentecost gets formed. Well, we never formed our own really ecclesiology. We just kind of took what we, you know, we had experienced in these other faith traditions. And then there's a man by the name of Grant Wacker. He wrote a book called Heaven Below. And he talks about the early days of Pentecost. And he talks about there was a very pragmatic approach. As much as Pentecostals talked about the spirit life, the heavenly life, being led by the Spirit, he said when you examine the decisions Pentecostals made, especially when it comes to evangelism, when it comes to the operation of the church, they're very pragmatic. They just started doing what worked best, what facilitated the mission the best. And so we have these two, you know, dynamics of we're bringing in what we know, you know, what our predecessors knew from their faith experiences before Pentecost, and then what works best in this fledgling movement. And so there's this thread of pragmatism that flows through Pentecost. Whatever works best, that's what we're going to do.
Yeah.
And we just kind of will do that and then hand that down as just kind of an accepted tradition, having never really contemplated why do we do it this way, or you know, what is the genesis or the reason for these practices.
Yeah. And you know, I'm thinking back to that time period, and we're talking about the 1900s, and we have to understand really— I feel like we have to understand the context of the Wesleyan holiness movement in the midst of the height of the modern age, the height of modernism, the height of even liberal scholarship in theological institutions like Harvard falling away from faith and really becoming more secularized. and then Wesleyan holiness being a reaction to that kinds of those kinds of things, combine that with the giants that the Pentecostal movement was occupied with, that were in essence bigger fish to fry than pastoral ecclesiology, right? What are those bigger fish? Baptism in the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongues. The bigger fish is baptism in Jesus' name, you know, holiness, practical holiness, prayer. And so it seems like, you know, to not be overly critical of that age of oneness Pentecostalism and the apostolic movement, there was some pretty big fish to fry, right?
Without a doubt.
And so pastoral ecclesiology is not in the forefront of contemplation, and I think your work is definitely contributes to our reflection on how are we practicing pastoral leadership and authority. What are some of the most interesting discoveries about the present state of pastoral leadership and authority, the different forms of pastoral authority that are practiced within the apostolic movement today? And what might be the implications for maybe some ways that you think we can benefit or move forward in the future based on what you have found today?
Sure. Yeah. Wow, man, there's so much to
it's
to
a huge yeah
to unpackage
huge topic,
there.
Yeah.
So I'll start with a quote, Peter Althaus, maybe not a direct quote, but a reference to a statement he made in a book. And Peter Althaus is a noted Pentecostal scholar, and he talks about in Pentecostalism as a whole, so not just our stream, oneness Pentecostalism, but as a whole, he said ecclesiology is underdeveloped. So, and in discussing that, one of the considerations is that, you know, Pentecostalism has changed. We've had the second wave and the third wave, you know, the charismatic movements come through, the neo-Pentecostal movement. Mm-hmm. And what we're finding is a lot of people are not leaving their previous denominations or their faith traditions. They're blending Pentecostalism with those faith traditions. Mm-hmm. And so it's all over the board when it comes to ecclesiology. It can look, you know, different ways depending on, you know, who you're looking at, which group you're looking at. So Pentecostalism is not homogenous. It is very, very, I mean, there's a lot of variety. Mm-hmm. So it's a varied movement with a lot of ways it expresses itself. Okay. When you start looking at oneness Pentecostalism, you find variety as well. And for example, I was raised in a different organization. I was raised in the Apostolic Assembly, and their approach is much more Presbyterian,
okay,
where authority is going to be given into the role of bishops and overseers, and there's going to be much more controlling authority given to the organization.
Mm-hmm.
When you juxtapose that against like the United Pentecostal Church, we embrace something called congregationalism, where and I'm not in my remarks, I'm just explaining the different approaches. I'm not trying to, you know, posit one against the other at this point in the discussion. The United Pentecostal Church has embraced congregationalism, which we grant autonomy to each local church. So we say each local church can really decide its own affairs and, you know, establish its own bylaws, choose the way it's going to select its pastor. Usually that's a democratic process of voting, but not always. And we're so congregationalist that in the UPC manual, it states that we're not going to force any church to conform to any one particular form of church government.
Okay.
So we do have churches in the United Pentecostal Church that practice plural elder rule, which means they have multiple pastors who share authority, and there is not one senior pastor above the others.
Mm.
Obviously, that's a minority, but I have interacted. I have met pastors that operate within that model, and they're champions of that model. The vast majority of United Pentecostal churches practice single elder congregationalism. By that is the church is autonomous. The church, that means the United Pentecostal Church does not tell a church how to, you know, run its affairs. There are some, you know, standard practices that we would hope every church would conform to. That's, you know, being obviously the belief system number one. Lifestyle is a major, you know, thing that is a part of our fellowship, it's part of our culture. And obviously ethical, moral standards with legal issues, financial issues. You know, we have understanding of how we want churches in our fellowship to operate. Mm-hmm. But as churches, you know, govern themselves, that is the expectation, that they're going to do so in a way that is appropriate, that is Christ-honoring, in a way that they will deem it best for their context.
Yeah.
For example, here in Stockton, the United Pentecostal Church does not tell Pastor Haney how to run Christian Life Center. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, you can travel out in any direction and pick another church from another city. The United Pentecostal Church is not going to tell that pastor how to run that church in that community. The congregationalism grants that autonomy. And so with single elder congregationalism, which is what the majority of our churches practice, they elect a senior pastor and they vest tremendous authority into that role. And so, you know, there are, in any system, whether you're looking at, you know, the Presbyterian model, the Episcopalian model, which the Catholic Church, the Orthodox Church maybe would be more in that stream, the Presbyterian model, which, you know, rule is among the bishops. Episcopalian rule is from the top down. You know, there's a central figure, like the Catholic Church has the Pope, and then authority is vested from that office downward. And then you have the congregational model, which each church is autonomous, and we can create fellowships. We can create, you know, a cohesion through an organization where we join together. But at the end of the day, each church is autonomous, and each church is responsible to govern its own affairs. And then we select a pastor to be our shepherd or to be, you know, the senior leader over that local congregation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, you know, it almost seems like when thinking about these organizational structures in terms of more biblical standards of kingdom identity, would it be safe to say of, you know, that any organization is not in and of itself the kingdom of God? In other words, the UPCI is not synonymous with the kingdom of God, though the kingdom of God flows through the organizational structure. It does not mean that they are equated. And if you would agree with that statement, what are the implications when we get these things mixed up?
Sure. I agree 100% with that statement, because I often will, you know, obviously teaching here in the college, I often say we have to realize that the church is a part of the kingdom of God, but it is not the totality of the kingdom of God. Mm-hmm. You know, the kingdom of God is beyond, you know, the scope of the church here on earth, yet the church is a vital and vibrant part of the kingdom of God. So yes, I absolutely would agree with that. You know, one thing I think we have to have tremendous humility, and one of the, you know, the realizations, Paul said, you know, knowledge puffeth up, and you have two approaches to gaining knowledge. You can either fill yourself with pride and think you know it all, and that your pride, your knowledge makes you better, or you can have this awareness that there's so much yet we don't know. Mm. And I feel like when you truly bring the spirit of humility or humble approach to the educational process, you will realize, okay, I'm researching, I'm discovering, but there's so much that I yet don't know. And I think as scholars, we need to, you know, take a humble approach and realize the United Pentecostal Church is not the center of the universe,
right?
You know? And I'm so thankful for our role in the kingdom of God. And I believe that God is blessing this movement, and great doors God is opening to this movement. And I believe that this movement, by and large, is doing an excellent job of advancing the kingdom and walking through those open doors that the Lord has given us. And you know, you can talk about education in the United Pentecostal Church. You talk about missions. I am so impressed, mm-hmm, with the global missions effort of the United Pentecostal Church.
Yes.
I'm so impressed with the North American missions effort. So I champion what the United Pentecostal Church is doing, and yet the humility is, we are a part of the kingdom, but yeah, definitely not the totality of the kingdom.
Yeah, yeah. You know, and a lot of individuals might, well, not a lot, well, some individuals might confuse those two kinds of things. And in this is that debate between authority that has been given by God and delegated authority. Mm-hmm. And whether God does move through delegated authority. In other words, does the district superintendent have spiritual authority over other people's ministries and other people's lives? And sometimes in a desire to seek a clear answer, we say yes or no, right? When being wise is actually a little bit tougher. Mm-hmm. It says, well, yes, in some ways, and no in others. You know, that's hard. It makes it hard. It's like, yes or no. Does an organizational authority have the right to tell me something about the way we are doing ministry, mm-hmm. right? Do they have an opinion that I am required by the Bible to obey? Or is it more like, you know, they have been selected amongst those that are part of the church, both organizationally and spiritually. They have been elected to a place of leadership that doesn't mean direct authority, but it certainly does mean maybe we should regard their voice as an influence,
sure.
even though they're not in control. You know, there's like a balance that has to be played between those
and
things.
And so what we do, right, we turn to Scripture for the answer.
Right, okay.
And yet, this is where humility comes in and honesty. Scripture's not always clear. You know, the New Testament church, we use the word primitive, not in a negative way, but they were figuring this stuff out on the fly.
Yeah.
And we can see cases for the congregational model. We can see evidence for the congregational model in the New Testament church, like in you know, the book of Acts and some of the early writings, we see it. But you can also see authority and bishops and overseers. And we see Paul sending Timothy to Ephesus and says, you appoint the elders. And there's no democratic process there.
Yeah, right. You know, there's no election.
No election. But then we see, you know, in Acts 6, the apostles say, hey, you guys pick out some men. So the church, you have a voice.
Yes.
Bring them to us. We approve them, we'll lay hands on them, and they're going to go do this ministry.
Wow.
So then you see a blending of models there, you know, and then yet Paul would write to Corinth, and he would say, hey, you guys get your act together before I show up. So he would put things in their hands to resolve.
Right.
And so, you know, the school I went to for my PhD, they're part of the Stone Campbell movement, which the Churches of Christ, you know, is a part of that fellowship. They practice plural elder congregationalism. And I went in so ready to dismiss their arguments, and I realized, like, they were quoting Scripture to back up their practices. And and so when you get into this, you realize, for example, the word elders is almost always in the plural in the New Testament. And so, you know, appoint elders in every city, and they would use some of these examples to say, hey, look, plurality of elders is biblical, and the Bible uses elders in the plural. And so I think we have to have that humility to say, in the New Testament, it's sometimes difficult to pin down the exact model. But I do believe the congregational model that we embrace, I believe there's evidence for that in the New Testament as well. Right. So understanding it, and again, I go back to the way Paul would write to the different churches, and we really do see that Paul expected them to handle their business.
Yeah.
And yet Paul knew that he had authority as an apostle to address things.
Yeah.
And so we see that there is such a thing as a recognized, you know, authority, individuals that do have authority, and yet the church is also responsible to take care of its own affairs. So how do we handle that in the modern context? A question I was asked the other day is had to do with marriage. And when does a marriage become valid? And one of my arguments is that God does flow through channels of authority. And the reason, you know, we would, you know, if you and I are both ministers, if someone came to us and they wanted to be married, what do? We're going to send them to the courthouse to get a marriage license, right?
Yeah.
Because our view is that for that marriage to be valid, you must follow the legal standards of the land. Mm-hmm. We'll come and perform the vow, but we have a vested authority from the government.
Yeah.
To perform, you know, to perform that wedding ceremony, officiate that wedding ceremony. If you and I were just to get up and perform a ceremony without that legal document, I propose that marriage is not valid. I propose, because of the context we live in, that God will honor the governmental authority, and that it is right for that couple to go and get that marriage license. And then you and I, as the officiant, obviously we're going to bring a spiritual element to it, but we are sealing something that is actually governmental in nature. Mm. So we see that God honors and flows through channels of authority. Well, I believe when we establish an organization like the United Pentecostal Church, we don't see, you know, the word general superintendent in the New Testament, but yet I believe God will honor the authority structure.
Okay.
And I will say this, and I have no Bible perhaps to establish what I'm going to tell a very personal experience, but I currently serve as the presbyter over the section. And I get asked to go minister in different churches in my role as a presbyter. And I honestly believe there's an authority that I walk in when I step into that pulpit as the presbyter. Mm-hmm. When they invite me in that role and say, we want you to speak to us as this, I don't believe I am the authority over that congregation. Right. But yet, when they open that door for me, I do feel the anointing of that position, of that role, as the pastors ask me to address things or to speak to the church in, you know, from the place of that role.
Yeah.
So I do, you know, in a very, you know, practical, you know, personal way, I do see where there is a conferred authority where the brethren have, you know, chosen to put me in this role. And as I walk in this role with the favor of God upon me, as I operate in that role, there is a special anointing upon that. I believe there's a special anointing upon David Bernard when he speaks as the general superintendent.
Right.
Do I believe that because he's that role, in that role, that you know, he has this authority to speak on behalf of God more than others?
Yeah.
I'm not going to go that far.
Okay.
But I do believe there's a special anointing upon him as the general superintendent.
Follows that delegation.
And he can give direction to our movement, and God will anoint him to give direction to our movement.
Yes.
So I know maybe I'm splitting hairs there.
Right.
You know.
Yeah, but it comes to show how important being spirit-led is.
Without a doubt.
You know, we by nature, the church is not bound to laws that say, if this, then that, then A, B, C, D, right? It really has to do with, you know, being spirit-led. So, for example, if you go to a church and you've been invited as the presbyter of the section, and the pastor says, as a presbyter, I want you to come to speak to my church, would it be different if they say, you know what, Pastor Lopez, you're my friend, and I want to invite you as my friend? Are those roles, or that is that authority different, right? I would venture to say yes, because the agreement between the pastor and the invited preacher is on nuanced terms.
Sure.
So you're not going to come in there as a presbyter. You're coming in there as a friend of that pastor. And perhaps that even opens you up to say things that you would say to a friend that you wouldn't say as a presbyter in a leadership capacity, in official leadership capacity. Maybe you have even more freedom to say, I'm not saying this as a delegated authority. I'm saying this as a friend of this, of the pastor, and a friend of this church, and give them more intimate direction in a service. And I'm just hypothetically thinking out loud. I think the Bible demonstrates that there should be room for these kinds of things, these flexible interactions between leaders and ministers. And really, it's based on upon what terms have we agreed on this church relationship at this moment in time.
I think what you're saying, and the biblical precedent for that, is you go back to Acts 15 when they're having the debate between, you know, circumcision and you know, do Gentile converts need to practice Judaism in order to be saved? And James said, it seemed good unto the Holy Ghost and to us.
Mm.
So they came to, we're being led by the Spirit, but we're also coming to agreement together.
Yeah.
And in that, and that's what we've done in United Pentecostal Church. We have come to agreement. We're going to set up this organization, and the ultimate purpose of the organization is to facilitate missions.
Yeah.
How can we reach the world? We can do more working together than we can all working individually.
Yeah.
So that is the primary goal, the whole gospel to the whole world by the whole church, is the advancement of the mission. And in that, though, we've created structures, you know, and you know, different positions and different layers, and we've agreed to that.
Right.
It seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us to operate this way, and God blesses it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it get distorted? Absolutely. And whenever there's humans, you know, politics, and power and positions, all the, we can mess up the most perfect plan. That's humans, and we mess up the Garden of Eden. We're good at this.
Yeah.
But yet God, we do see where when we operate with integrity and character and purity in the structure that we agree upon, and there's no perfect human structure, God blesses it.
Yes. And that's why I love the Bible, because the Bible is very transparent with even its stories within the apostles that are that way. I mean, just look at the relationship between James, Peter, and Paul, right? James is not an official apostle of the 12, right? He is James, the brother of Jesus, in a leadership role. Wait a second. He seems to be the leader of the Jerusalem church where other apostles are there. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, you know, and then Paul recognizes, he says in scripture that he perceived that it seemed that Peter and James were authorities. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, Paul says, I resisted Peter to his face.
Yes.
When he was doing something that was unethical, he was preferring some brethren, which were the Jewish Christians, over the Gentile Christians. And then we have this mutual submission where Peter says in his own book, he says, Paul, an apostle who writes scripture, and people criticize him for what he's teaching, not understanding what he's teaching. Mm-hmm. And his letter, Peter, I believe, written after Paul criticizes or corrects Peter. Peter says, that's scripture, right? The apostle, in essence, he's saying, you know that thing that Paul criticized me about? That's the word of God, right?
Amazing.
I love it. It's so powerful.
Without
it's
a doubt.
So powerful. And it gives us very powerful narratives and stories of the greatest among us in the history of the church being humble towards one another, submitting to one another, and following each other's leadership as they are being led by the Spirit, as they're being led by the Lord.
So, and there's an important word, accountability.
Yeah.
You know, and we see accountability there. Now, again, it was a primitive church. They're trying to figure this out as they go, and they're going to use the synagogue model, you know, to establish early congregations. That just made sense. It's what, you know, the first 10 years of the church, the church is primarily Judaic. It's almost everyone is either Jewish or a convert to Judaism. Only, you know, later we see in the book of Acts where, you know, begins obviously with the house of Cornelius, but then even beyond that begins to expand. And then the Gentiles don't have that framework of the synagogue model. And so, you know, how are they going to have accountability? And we see cases like this where it was raw, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Paul tells that account in Galatians, and it's so raw, but yet they realize there has to be accountability even in the ministry.
Yes.
And I think that's why, you know, I have friends that they're independent. And fine, I guess, for them. I didn't want to be independent. I was a young minister.
Yeah.
I was about 27 years old when I got my ministerial credentials with the UPC. And the what drove me is accountability.
Yeah.
I wanted somebody to be, and I'm going to use a colloquial term, I want somebody to yank my chain, you know, to, when I'm getting out of line, you know, a district board can pull me in, or a presbyter, or a district superintendent, or a general superintendent, someone, you know, that with that delegated authority, that conferred authority, can say, Brother Lopez, what you said there, what you're teaching there, your attitude, you know, and yes, you know, I'm submitted to my pastor, but one day if I'm a senior pastor, who will I be accountable to?
Yeah.
And so, you know, that's drove me. Good. And I think that's one of the benefits of an organization is accountability.
Yeah.
And people who don't want accountability, I think they're in a very dangerous place.
Yeah.
And you brought up where Peter had enough humility. I mean, it's Peter.
Yes.
It's
right.
I mean, he has the keys of the kingdom.
The preaching of the church.
And yet, you know, Paul, and I, you know, I'm going to embellish the story. The Greek word Paul means small. So I always say, you know, Paul was this short little preacher, and Peter's this big rough fisherman, and the short little preacher, you know, withstood the big tall burly fisherman. I'm embellishing, you know, total poetic license there. But I love how Peter accepted the accountability, the correction.
Oh my.
And instead of being bitter against Paul's ministry, he honors Paul's ministry.
And at the same time, we see Paul also submitting himself. He goes to Jerusalem and they question him on his preaching.
Yes.
They say, just like the situation that you're saying amongst the district, that we heard that you're teaching something that might be questionable. Allow us to have a conversation with you. Come to Jerusalem. He goes to Jerusalem and he says, this is what I've been teaching. He wasn't offended by it.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't say, well, how dare you call me? Don't you realize that I'm an apostle? Don't you trust me? Wouldn't you trust me in my spiritual authority? And he didn't use these many times human defense systems that we use when we get offended, you know, that somebody has questioned our actions. If anything, if someone disagrees with something that I've taught, now I'm a professor here at Christian Life College. If there is a lecture that comes into question and perhaps maybe students interpret it a different way, or maybe I said something that needs to be corrected, why would I be offended if my brethren bring me aside and say, we heard that you said this, what did you mean? I am honored. I feel it's an opportunity. Allow me to clear my name. Allow me to share. And it's a place where we trust what Christ, how Christ is ministering to us through one another.
Absolutely.
And then the apostles, they told Paul, look, you know, the Jews, they're doubting your unity. Why don't you take a vow with them? There's a few people that are taking a vow in the temple. And take a vow with them. What does Peter do?
He
shaves his head.
He submitted to
it. You know, he's willing to do things that even are, and this is a big, larger theological discussion perhaps, but he participates in Mosaic law actions. Mm-hmm. That vow is only found in the Mosaic law. It was likely a Nazirite vow. And he shaves his head, but for the sake of the unity of the brethren, he's willing to cross these lines because there's a bigger thing, harmony, right?
Beautiful.
You know, and let me just add this one more detail. Maybe you can react to it. I think the more apostolic we are, okay, the more we are going to reflect this chain of story within the book of Acts. What provoked the apostles to be afraid of, not afraid or concerned, worried, not in a negative way, but wanting to know what is Paul teaching? Apostolic revival. Mm. The ministry of Paul was so successful and it was spreading so fast. He was experiencing so much apostolic revival that people were like, let me just confirm that you're still with us because we're hearing things, but we want to confirm with you. Apostolic revival was a major contributor to that situation, you know? And I think the more churches we plant, the more churches rise up and pop up, the more young ministers and old ministers are successful and the church grows and it's powerful, we are going to have conflict and opportunities to say, are they still with, is he still teaching the truth? Why don't you come together? Let's come and talk. Let's have coffee. Let's have dinner and let's talk and let's just make sure that we're on the same page and we shouldn't be offended by that because that's actually the mark of biblical Book of Acts apostolic revival. And we have to check each other's bases sometimes, and that's okay.
You know, look at what Paul's response could have been.
Mm.
Paul could have said, who are you guys?
Right.
I'm the one going out there. I'm the one spending my health, my resources, yeah, my life. I've had results you guys have never. He could have had such a haughty attitude.
Yes.
And you know, and I've been doing this a while now, and obviously in the role where I serve our district, I've seen some approach of some ministers like, who are you to tell me what to do? Mm-hmm. Have you done what I've done? Have you? Mm. And I juxtapose that against Paul, who really did humble himself,
yes,
for the sake of unity,
yes,
and for the sake of revival. He,
yes,
knew that if he had the blessing of the elders in Jerusalem,
yes,
it would further his opportunities,
yes,
to minister. And you know, we could all have different personalities, you know,
yeah,
and I'm not... I'm thankful for those in leadership who have really, really strong personalities.
Yeah.
They often will accomplish things that others won't. They're just going to, mm-hmm, push through obstacles, and God will use them in a great way.
Yeah.
But for every minister, and myself included, there must always be an altar that we fall upon it and we are broken before the Lord.
Yes.
And there was a great quote that Andrew Murray said. He said, and I'm not going to quote it exactly, but he said, ultimately, humility before God is nothing if,
yeah,
it is not expressed in humility before my brethren.
Yes. Wow.
And Andrew Murray was a Scottish minister, and I love that quote. He wrote and he ministered in the late 1800s, early 1900s. I love that quote because if I'm really going to walk in the fear of God and be humble before God, ultimately that's expressed in the way I treat my brother,
mm,
and it's going to be expressed in the way I conduct myself within an organization,
yeah,
that I choose to be a part of.
Yes. Wow. Yeah, that book you actually shared, the book by Murray on humility with the staff and the faculty at Christian Life College, you know, and it was just so powerful. It was so powerful, and it got me. It sent me into quite a few moments of just meditating on the power of humility, because some people see meekness as weakness.
Mm-hmm.
They see humility as evidence that you don't have a backbone, when really the opposite is true. For me to be humble for me to be willing to submit myself to you, I know that you can't do anything to harm me because I'm a child of God. Mm-hmm. I can afford to follow. I can afford to be led. I can afford to be accountable because ultimately my sense of identity is not based on my position. It's not based on my title. It's based on that I'm a child of God.
Without a doubt.
I've been washed in the blood. I'm worth something to God, and I can afford to humble myself to this situation and to this leader. By any chance, just quickly, can you give kind of a synopsis of that book, Humility, and kind of how you apply that, how you would apply that to leaders right now who might be struggling with that thought of humbling themselves to and other individuals,
sure.
You know?
Sure. Well, what I do is I'll take the conversation outside of the book, then I'll come back to it.
Okay.
Romans 1:1, to me, is a perfect example. You know, in our movement today, we are championing the fivefold ministry, and you know, we're acknowledging, hey, we believe that the fivefold ministry is alive and well within the church, and that there are apostles, there are prophets. That's Brother Gleason, our assistant general superintendent, I've heard him at general conference in a minister session speak on this, a very, very powerful session. I've heard him teach at our own district conference on the fivefold ministry. In fact, some of that has actually come into towards the end of my dissertation, just, you know, a real, real brief discussion of the fivefold ministry. And Paul makes this statement, Romans 1:1, Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle. Mm. Before he ever championed his apostolic authority, he championed his servant identity.
Mm.
And you understand, you know, the Greek word bondservant is the Greek word doulos. It's the same word that we would translate slave.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I'm a slave of Jesus Christ. If we want to truly walk in apostolic authority, you know, for Paul or prophetic authority, whatever you feel your role might be in the fivefold ministry, you want to walk in the power, the authority of that position God has given you within his kingdom, you must first embrace the identity of a servant.
Yeah.
And I love how that was Paul's approach. He said, yes, I'm an apostle, and I'm not afraid to be known as an apostle.
Mm.
He said, but first, I'm a slave. I'm a bondservant. I'm this. And to me, so when we talk about the book Humility, it is showing us the power of following the example of Christ. Jesus said, I am meek and lowly.
Mm-hmm.
He said that. And then Moses, the Bible says he was the meekest man on the face of the earth, you know? We have these incredible leaders, Moses, the greatest leader of the Old Testament, Jesus, the greatest leader of all, and they both embraced humility in their leadership, you know? And so, you know, the Bible message, and Andrew Murray, his book is basically an exposition on the power of the virtue of humility and how it brings the blessing of God.
Mm.
There's a proverb, and it makes a statement, by humility and the fear of the Lord are riches and honor and life.
Wow.
Like God honors, he resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble.
Yes.
There's something about humility that is so attractive to God.
Yeah.
And I found this, that even when I'm right, you know, sometimes there'll be a conflict and I'm right and I know I'm right and bless God, I know I'm right.
Yeah.
And I have found though, that if I will take the humble approach, God always stands with me.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems, you know, contrary to what you would figure, no, I've got to, you know, I've got to fight for this and I've got to, you know, and I'm not talking about doctrinal matters. I'm not talking about, you know, those sacrosanct things that all of us would shed our blood for, you know, our the core of our belief system. But I'm talking about, you know, sometimes those interpersonal conflicts that can happen between brothers.
Right.
I've learned if I take the humble approach, God has always stood with me.
Yeah.
And God really does give grace to the humble.
Yes.
It really does work.
Wow.
The Beatitudes really do work.
Yeah. Wow. You know, the Apostle Paul, I feel, gives some direction on further direction on this, or at least the grace that we should offer one another, even if one is more right than the other. What is right to do is often different than what is more correct or less correct. And let me kind of explain what is coming up in my mind is in Corinthians, he talks about how some watered and some planted, but only God gives the increase. And he says, I, as a master builder, I'm coming and I'm building the house of the Lord. And some build with wood, some build with hay, some build with stubble. others with precious stones, others with metal, with silver and gold. He said, but this is the temple of God. And he gives direction to say, in the end, God will test all of these works by fire, and we will be saved even as through fire. What is he saying? God is going to test the building materials that men of God have used as master builders to build the church. Some of those building materials aren't as quality as others, right? And in this, the debate comes in. Is it better to get up at 4 a.m. to pray or 5 a.m., right? Mm-hmm. Wait a second. The cool of the day theologically actually means the evening. The evening is the best time to pray, right? And there's these debates on when, what time should we pray? 3 times a day or 5 times a day, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. And we have men of God who are building in the kingdom. Mm-hmm. They are constructing the church to the best of their ability, their knowledge, their understanding. Some are planting, others are watering. But in the end, God is going to test it all. And he will give a reward according to the work of every man. In that context, he says that I'm going to judge that. Then in chapter 4, the Apostle Paul says, I'm careful not even to judge myself, because I'm not the Lord, and God is going to judge me in that time. So even my own teachings, I'm careful not to be overcritical about what I am teaching, because I know that God, he is going to test the quality of teaching. That tells me multiple things, okay? That tells me multiple things. That says, first of all, have grace towards your brother, your fellow co-laborer. Have grace towards them, because you may think that perhaps they're not building. That's not good teaching. That's not quite accurate. You know, that sermon, it was out of context, right?
Yeah.
Oh, they could have said it a little better, or their point that they, well, we have to grant grace. Why? Because they are trying to build and we don't come and destroy the temple. You know, I don't come behind a preacher and tell the congregation, well, yeah, you know, they preached a good message, but, you know, they said this wrong. You're tearing down the temple of God, you know, by tearing down the work of another man. Now, some things do need to be corrected, sure, right? Not saying that they don't, but I'm saying we need to be gracious and cautious and humble ourselves to one another. And at the same time, we also need to be gracious towards ourselves.
So, you know, I've been doing this a little while now. I look back at some of the things I said in my early days of ministry.
Oh my, yes.
If the tapes exist,
please erase them.
I will pay good money to get every copy I can and burn them.
Oh,
you know,
my Lord.
You learn and you grow, you know. Yes. And I have had the privilege, you and I both, we've been through obviously Bible college and graduating and having the knowledge that we gained, but then we went and got our master's degrees and we were stretched further, mm-hmm, you know, and then mm-hmm, both you and I have our PhDs and that stretched us in incredible ways. And not everyone has that privilege. And one, we need to have grace to that maybe may not have the same level of training. But I have to look back and realize in my own life, like, I really said that?
Yeah.
I really believe that?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness, you know? And yet God had mercy on me. God didn't strike me with lightning. And you know,
God was gracious.
There was Kenneth Haney probably shaking his head. Yeah, being like,
this young one.
Who is this guy? But he didn't give up on me. It was a pastor that worked with me. And even
so
Pastor
grateful.
Nathaniel Haney, mm-hmm, you know, he's
absolutely
been my pastor for over 20 years now. And I know I've said things before where he's like, nope.
Yeah.
You know, but he worked with me, you know, whether it's an office conversation or sometimes maybe he just took it to prayer and he mm-hmm, let God work it out mm-hmm, in me. But so what are you talking about? That grace that we have towards one another? Absolutely. And I have minister friends of mine. They really are friends that they say it in ways that I wouldn't say it.
Mm-hmm.
And they say it in ways that maybe I don't feel comfortable saying it. But I am not going to tear down their right to say it the way that they feel God wants them to say it.
Right.
That every servant will answer to his own master. Mm-hmm. That's a principle in the book of Romans. And so if God has laid it on my brother's heart to say it that way and to say it with that much conviction, it is not my job to tear that down in mm-hmm, any way, because mm-hmm, the same is true of me. There are flags that I have planted and I feel they're from the Lord in my life. And you or another brother may look at me and say, I don't know about that.
Yeah.
But And that's what's beautiful about the fellowship. That's what's beautiful about the United Pentecostal Church is if you look at the preamble, there is an acknowledging that we're all unique and that we're not going to contend.
Yeah.
That is actually a part of the foundational document of the United Pentecostal Church, that we're not going to contend for our own unique views in some of these areas. Now, the new birth, the oneness of God, you know, these things are established, they are not for sale. But then there's acknowledgement that we're going to have our individual approaches, but let's work together in harmony.
Yeah.
Let's work together in unity. Yeah. And I love that about our fellowship. And I think by and large, we do that.
Yeah.
I honor, like, going back to an earlier, you know, statement, I understand the United Pentecostal Church is not the center of the universe, but in my humble opinion, I think it's the best thing going.
Yeah.
I love being a part of this fellowship. Yeah. I love what God is doing in the United Pentecostal Church. Mm-hmm. And I'm very thankful to be a part of it.
Yeah. I would agree. And I respect what God is doing through many other oneness organizations.
Without a doubt. Oh, yes.
In fact, even in this Bible college, we have had at one time 7 different apostolic organizations represented in the student body. I love it. You know, and God is working through so many organizations that God bless them. And I pray that God would empower them. Well, you know, I'm very grateful to be part of the UPCI because, to my understanding, especially internationally and globally, I really don't see another organizational structure making the global impact that the UPCI is making at this point in time. That's not a plea to have people join the UPCI,
no,
right?
Not at all.
That's not a plea, because I think there's a lot of character and spiritual development that happens if you stay faithful to the place where God planted you. There are times to move on, you know, and I think Brother Bernard gave some incredible insights when he was on the podcast with us in that regard, that there are times where you move on to both other congregations or other places, other regions. Maybe a pastor becomes a missionary becomes a pastor, and authorities are kind of switched around. There has to be that flexibility in the kingdom of God. But there is also something very special about simply staying submitted to where God has placed you, and make sure the work of God is occurring that He wants to in your life during that season of time.
No, so last night, and this is so, you know, apropos, my wife and I were driving to the Bay Area. We were leading a prayer meeting for a section in the Bay Area. And I got a text from a young minister that I was his youth pastor here at Christian Life Center many years ago. When he left Stockton, when he left CLC, he went to a church in another organization, and he actually began to thrive working under his pastor there. Really, this pastor really invested in him, and I honor his pastor for investing in my friend and in this young man who, you know, came out of our youth group here, was set aside, put into the ministry, has actually received his credentials with this other organization, and now he is in another state, sent there by the organization to establish a church. And he called me yesterday to let me know that he just met with the bishop and got approval, and he's starting to look for church property.
Yeah.
All I did was celebrate what God is doing in his life.
Yes.
My hope and prayer is that God will give him great revival.
Yes.
And I'm excited for him and where he's at in his organization,
mm-hmm.
and that the blessing and the hand of God is upon him as God uses him and as he is flowing through the authority that's in his organization. Never am I going to try to pull him out of that organization.
Yeah.
God has put his hand, a blessing upon him. God has opened doors for him.
Yeah.
That's where God has planted him.
Right.
So you and I are very similar as we acknowledge the blessing and what God is doing through other organizations, and never want it to be misinterpreted that we're trying to tear them down to build up the UPC.
Yeah.
You know, at the same time, I'm very grateful for where God has planted me.
Right.
And I'm very grateful that, you know, where God has planted you.
Yeah. Okay. Let's move on to another subject that I brought up just before we started here. And that is leadership styles, because on one level, we're talking about the relationship between the organization and pastors and pastoral models. But now I want to extend that conversation even further between the relationship between the pastor or the pastoral authority model that is in any given congregation and the people,
sure.
the congregants. There are different approaches to leading and ministering to the congregation, some in their extreme forms, really modeling more like totalitarian leadership models, where they micromanage everything, every part of a saint's life. They tell them when to buy a house, when to buy a car, when to, you know, and they're, you know, very involved with the micro decisions of people's lives. On the other hand, on the there are models where pastors really, you know, don't decide what they're going to preach on Sunday. They give out surveys to say what sermon you want to hear, you yeah. know, and they let the sheep, you know, and the congregation really dictate what you're going to teach and preach. And so we're and I'm talking about the extremes to help us come up with some principles. What are some pitfalls of these extremes? I want to kind of discuss some pitfalls of these extremes and how can we find a more biblical, wise middle of the road sure. and things. So, yeah.
Well, so if I could just kind of maybe reference my research, I'm going to kind of answer the question coming around the bend a little bit. Okay. So in the United Pentecostal Church, culturally, you know, why do we do what we do? We embrace single elder congregationalism, and there's biblical evidence for it, and I'm in support of that. I believe the single elder rule model is better for church leadership. Okay. I believe it avoids confusion. Mm. Throughout the pattern of Scripture, we always see that there was a strong leader over mm-hmm. God's people. Yeah. Like, yeah. That's just the biblical pattern. Mm. And so, and even, you know, among the 12, it seems like Peter was raised up as a spokesman. Mm-hmm. So you typically in the Bible, we get this pattern of a leader emerging among God's people to provide leadership to God's people. And so it's a biblical model. So I embrace single elder congregationalism. I love the autonomy of the local church, and having a shepherd who is responsible to serve the people. Now, so we have this. How do we practice single elder congregationalism? Well, mm. when the United Pentecostal Church was formed, and you look at the Assemblies of God, and the new issue arose over baptism in Jesus' name, and there was a splintering off. And then we have several oneness groups begin to form. And there were multiple oneness groups formed. Finally, we get what's called the merger. In our history, we get the merger where two prominent groups decide to come together and join together. And from that, we get the United Pentecostal Church. So, and this, this is about 20 years of history. I've shortened yeah. in about 30 seconds. So we get the United Pentecostal Church, which was formed out of the merger of two oneness organizations that really have their roots coming out of the Assemblies of God, and so on and so forth. So when you begin to look at what was going on and the development of the United Pentecostal Church, we made a decision, we're not going to contend, but we're going to work together. This is our foundational beliefs. Let's unite on this. Mm. Okay. But then there was a culture that arose that was not always defined. So you get different mm-hmm. writers begin okay. to write, and you get men like J.T. Pugh. Mm. You get men like a Kenneth Haney. You get men Paul Dugas. I was thinking his brother was one of my teachers, Brother mm-hmm. Phil Dugas, Brother Paul Dugas. And they began to write about the structure of the church or the role of pastors and different ones. And in more modern times, more contemporary context, but men like Carlton Coon, men like David Bernard, they're writing about the role of the pastor. And what I decided to do was I went back and I examined 17 documents written by UPC
okay.
voices.
Okay.
That talk about the role of the pastor and how they understood it. And so it was very interesting. It was really kind of a historical journey. And you go back to some of the earlier writings, then into some of the more contemporary writings, and you do see some things that haven't changed, but you do see a shifting in some of the language. One of the words that was used in some of the early writings, Dugas uses this word, Haney uses this word, I included the works of Nathaniel Wilson. I know he's not presently a part of the United Pentecostal Church, but when he was a member of our fellowship, mm-hmm. he actually wrote a pastor's training course.
Okay.
And in six of the documents I examined, this word called theocratic church government or theocracy okay. yeah. came up. And it's a very interesting term.
Yeah.
Now, if you take it to its extreme, it is the rule of God in it through an individual. So, mm-hmm. it's a theocracy is ultimately where God is the ruler and God's going to appoint someone that he rules through.
Okay.
So they took this concept and they applied that and said God rules his church through the ministry. But even in using the term, there's different ways it was expressed. Like
yeah.
Dugas expresses it in very strong terms. But Haney expresses it in more nuanced terms. So even though they're using the same term, and then I had a conversation with Dr. Norris, and he said, you know, that perhaps they didn't understand the full implications of what the word would mean, you know?
Yeah. And, ramifications.
The ramifications.
The consequences 20 years after.
He said, you know, are we sometimes just using words that sound good, you know? Right. And I'm not demeaning or diminishing these writers in any way. In fact, one of my goals was, because these works are not considered scholarly, my goal was to include them in my dissertation, to bring them into the scholarly conversation, to bring them into the academic conversation. So now if anyone, you know, researches my work, they will see that I'm quoting Pew, I'm quoting Haney, I'm quoting Dugas, I'm quoting Wilson, I'm quoting, and I wanted their voices to be a part of our academic conversation in the United Pentecostal Church and in the oneness movement. And so we use this term called theocracy, and where, so it became culturally accepted that the pastor in our churches, by and large, is given authority over the congregation. He is, and it's an odd-sounding word, but it's grammatically correct, he's the decider.
Okay.
You know, and he'll work with the church board, but there's a short little book called Meet the United Pentecostal Church. It's a short little book. It's like a primer on how the UPC operates. And this book basically says that, hey, the pastor, that boards are appointed to serve the pastor. So we get this role put in of the pastor, and we give him tremendous authority. It's a cultural thing with us. And it's not this view is not shared in other streams of Christianity. It's something that we embrace. So I began looking, are there other groups that share our high view of the pastor, are giving the pastor this level of authority within the local congregation? And actually in the 80s and 90s, in the Southern Baptist Convention, there was a internecine fight that broke out within, and I say fight, maybe that's an overstatement, but this conflict within the Southern Baptist Convention over the role of the pastor. Okay. And what spurred it was this doctrine of the priesthood of believers. And some pastors felt like that was watering down the authority of the pastor. And you get strong voices like Criswell, which was a strong voice in their fellowship. And so you have this conflict that went on within the Southern Baptist Convention, and the conservatives won. They came out, and it was put into a resolution that was passed that said the pastor is the ruler of the congregation. The pastor does have this God-given authority. And so the United Pentecostal Church is not the only group that has embraced this. And it was interesting to see another group wrestling with the authority of the pastor. So we align with other conservative elements of Christianity that acknowledges pastors have a God-given authority in their church. We don't believe that being a pastor is just a democratic process. Maybe the church voted to install that pastor, but we do believe once the pastor is established, you know, in his role, that there's a divinely granted authority in his leadership in that local congregation. So, and I'm leaving out so much, you know, to give you a short synopsis. So in that, we allow for pastors to take tremendous authority. And some pastors do that to the extreme. One of my dangers, so at the conclusion of my dissertation, I listed two dangers and three areas where we could operate within our single congregational model and do it safely. So the two dangers was the danger of the cult of personality.
Okay.
And this is where the pastor builds the church all around him.
Okay.
And because of our culture and our framework, that is a very real possibility, that a pastor will view himself as the central authority in the church, and everything he says goes, and everything has to be run through him, and almost elevating himself to a place alongside or even sometimes superseding scripture.
Okay.
Comments are be saying, you know, is I will tell you what the Bible says.
Yeah.
You know?
Right.
And those are the extreme cases, but thus we do sometimes have those types of situations, and very, very dangerous. So I address that, like the cult of personality where the pastor feels like every decision has to run through him. I think that's very unhealthy. And I think it limits the growth of a church. I think it limits what a church can do and what a church can be.
Yeah.
Because if a pastor has to be involved in every single decision, then by the nature of that model, leadership is not going to expand because everything's going to be locked up within one individual.
Right.
Okay. So the cult of personality where a pastor says, everything flows through me, I make every decision, you know, and I just heard from an individual, and I'm not going to give details where they're from, location, anything like that, but the setting was that, you know, the pastor decides if and when you go on vacation, the type of car you drive, you know, and so on and so forth. The pastor's involved in all those decision-making processes. Processes. You and I come from a church that's completely not that way.
Yeah.
Pastor Haney shows tremendous confidence in the men of God that work with him.
Yeah.
And then also towards his congregation, you know.
The fathers of the home, the mothers of the home and their decisions.
And you have to be spirit-led in the decisions you make, and you have to be biblically based in the lifestyle that you live.
Yeah.
But, you know, some pastors will go to the extreme on taking this concept of theocracy and say, you know, God rules the church through me.
Yeah.
And so I think that, you know, that is a dangerous element that we need to not be afraid to discuss and say, hey, this is probably an unhealthy expression of leadership.
Yeah.
And how can we address this in our movement?
Right.
Another, you know, danger that my dissertation, the conclusion came to is burnout. We expect a lot out of our pastors.
Yeah, yeah.
That's and you know, just writing, you know, reading through the writings of these great men of God like Pugh and Haney and different ones, when they start talking about the responsibilities of the pastor, it's like, wow, a pastor has to be an expert in so many areas, has to do so many things. And I think burnout is a very real danger for pastors within our model because we expect so much of them.
Yeah.
And then the three areas of safety was the safety of teamwork. If pastors will embrace the team model of ministry, which is the New Testament model of ministry, when you look at Paul traveled with the team, the 12 was a team, you know, you go through and you see New Testament ministry was always operated within the structure of a team or facilitated through a team. It doesn't diminish a man's authority. Paul was no less an apostle for traveling within a team with a team, but he understood I can't do it all by myself. So the safety of teamwork in ministry, the safety of servant leadership. And this is where I'm going to kind of zero in on responding to you. How can we embrace single elder congregations where we grant tremendous honor and authority to the pastor of a congregation, where we recognize the divine nature of that authority? We believe that God really does raise up pastors and God puts an anointing upon pastors and God uses pastors. But how can pastors operate within that role and not develop a cult of personality, not develop authoritarianism or totalitarianism? I heard a man of God make this statement, and I don't think I'm taking him out of context, but I have a lot of problems with this statement. The man of God said this. He said, when you look at the face of your pastor, it should be as if you're looking at the face of God. Mm. I honor my pastor. I'm submitted to my pastor. I obey my pastor. I do. That's the life that I live, right? I live a life of submission to the man of God that's in my life.
Yeah.
But my pastor's not God.
Yeah.
My pastor will be the first to tell you that he's not God. Mm-hmm. I have a pastor that has a very, very healthy view of himself and a very healthy expression of leadership. And so this concept of servant leadership, we see that exemplified in Jesus Christ. Now, some people are afraid of servant leadership. And there was a church leadership guru, Peter Wagner. He wrote the books on church leadership, the church growth movement. And he did not like servant leadership because he felt like taken to its extreme, it weakened the authority of a pastor. And I can understand where he's coming from, but Jesus made this statement. He said, "You call me Lord," and he said, "You're right, I am."
Mm-hmm.
And in the very next, in that whole passage, he gets down and washes the feet of the apostles.
Right.
He says, you acknowledge that I'm your Lord.
Yeah.
Servant leadership does not diminish a pastor's authority, does not diminish his role.
Yeah.
But what it does is it informs his approach.
Yeah.
I stand in the pulpit, not as the dictator, but as the servant leader. Right. I'm here to serve. Because every time a man of God steps to the pulpit, one of two entities is going to be fed.
Yeah.
He's either going to feed himself and his ego, or he's going to feed the flock.
Yeah.
And servant leadership says, my role is to feed the flock.
Yeah.
Servant leadership grabs the towel like Jesus did and washes the feet. And that's Jesus said, this is the example you're to follow.
Yeah.
You're not to be like the Gentiles where you lord it over everyone, but you humbly serve.
Right.
And Jesus had no problem acknowledging that he was Lord, yeah. that he was master, that he was ruler. Paul had no problem acknowledging that he was apostle.
Yeah.
You know, you go through these different great leaders that we see in the Bible. Being a servant leader does not diminish one's role or authority. Being a servant leader allows for the healthy expression of yeah. pastoral leadership.
Right.
And then the third conclusion I came to was the safety of accountability, which I think is actually an outgrowth of servant leadership. When I embrace servant leadership, I am not afraid of accountability. I actually realize accountability is a safety. It's going to keep me in a safe place and keep my leadership healthy.
Yeah.
So I don't know if I answered it. The question fully.
No, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And being a servant leader reminds me of what we said earlier about humility. It's servant leadership is really the foundation of servant leadership is humility, in that you trust in God as you serve, it's not a sign of weakness to serve. It's not a sign of weakness to understand that I'm here to empower this congregation. Like if I'm a pastor, I'm here to empower them to become everything that they can be, you know? And so I tend to think of pastors as stewards. They are stewards of the people of God. They're administrators of the economy of God within that local congregation. They are stewards of the gifts that are resident within the congregation. It's not that they lord over the gifts. It's that they administrate the gifts and say, you know what? You have a very powerful, for example, you have a very powerful gift of mercy and giving, and it seems like you would function well under this ministry. And I want you to release your strengths and your gifts in this ministry. Would you join the outreach team? Or would you join the youth leadership team? And you are finding the gifts that are in the congregation, people who have gifts of wisdom and gifts of understanding, the spiritual gift of wisdom. We say, you know what? This is what we're going to do. We're going to train you to be a premarital counselor, right? Why? Because you're putting them in you're a steward of the gifts that are in their lives. And as a pastor, you use your authority to place them where they could be effective in the body of Christ. And that way, it's like this authority, but the authority also recognizes the fact that all the gifts don't dwell in me as a pastor. All the gifts dwell in the church, and I have the precious privilege and honor of administering the church in a way that enables all of these gifts to show themselves in the body and to manifest themselves in the community we reach our cities.
Without a doubt. And I think through what you're describing through servant leadership, actually a leader's influence is expanded exponentially.
Mm-hmm.
As I empower others, as now in my leadership's not just tied up in me, now I have invested in others. And Kenneth Haney was to me the great example that I served under and that I came into the ministry under. He empowered others. And as a result, his influence was magnified across the congregation.
Yeah.
He didn't care what color car you drove,
yeah.
you know, but he wanted everyone to understand, like, you have a vital role to play in the kingdom.
Yes.
And so identity. Through that, Kenneth Haney's leadership was multiplied
yeah.
because we understood that we were operating under his leadership,
right.
but empowered to do what God had equipped us to do.
Exactly. And, you know, we see if we examine the psychological, emotional development of children who grow up in overbearing households. I've counseled individuals and talked to individuals that everything was decided for them. When they got up, when they went to sleep, what they did, it was almost like a military childhood. They really didn't get to play. They don't get to express themselves. They don't have the freedom of their own choices. Those individuals, when they go out into the world as adults, many times do not have that healthy sense of identity and autonomy or agency to say, I can do this and I can do that. And I could, because they grew up in an environment where all the decisions were made for them.
Yes.
You know, because it's almost like the parent was so afraid that they would make a bad decision that I'd rather decide it for you, right? But so much of the will of God even occurs through our failures. Like, God uses our bad decisions and our failures to help us grow as an individuals. I venture to say that God is not just tolerant of our failures. He actually expects them and uses them so that we can gain a healthy sense of self and trust in God that, yes, I need the empowerment of the Holy Spirit, but also I'm always going to need his grace mm-hmm. because I'm not going to be perfect all the time. And, you know, it's okay. That's okay. Not because my failures and my sins are okay,
yes.
but because in the grand scheme of things, if I keep falling on God and I keep resting on the grace and the empowerment of the Spirit and the mercy of God, we're going to make it. We're going to be all right, you know, and that's where healthy agency occurs.
Wow.
I think where leaders are overbearing and deciding everything, the church doesn't have their own sense of self. They don't have their own sense of self. And really, that's where burnout comes out, right? Because if a pastor has been making all the decisions, can the pastor leave for 2 weeks on vacation?
He can't.
You know, can he take some time away yeah. and say, you know, I'm leaving you guys in charge of this. Make sure that nothing burns down, right? No. Why? Because they don't have that sense of self. And so burnout occurs because we were not built by God to be able to handle the burden of omniscience.
Yeah.
What should happen when and where? Omniscience belongs to God alone, mm-hmm. you know? And so I think a lot of burnout happens because we're over-managing people and we're over-contemplating all the ways that things could go wrong. So we're trying to make decisions for people's lives. And some water, some plant, but we also always have to remember only God gives the increase.
So one of my favorite passages, and we're Pentecostal, so we get excited about certain passages in the Bible. And Jesus said, upon this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. That's the King James rendering. And we get so excited. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church. We get so excited. I get more excited about the first part. Mm. Upon this rock, I will build my church.
Mm-hmm.
It's not my church. Mm. It's his church. Mm-hmm. And he said he would build it. Like you talked about, a steward, or I'm a facilitator mm-hmm. to help God build his church. But I ultimately, I can't build the church. And when I got that understanding, it took a weight of responsibility off my shoulders. Now, mm-hmm. I'm going to give everything I have for the kingdom.
Yes,
I'm going to go to heaven tired. You know, that's kind of a mantra that I live by. I mean, I'm going to pour myself out.
Yeah.
So I'm not talking about being lazy or being careless. I'm not talking about, but I can't build the church.
Yeah.
The church is a spiritual entity.
Yeah.
I can't save one soul. I can't make someone live for God, love mm-hmm. God, even though I wish I could. I can't do any of that.
Yeah.
But I can do my part, and then ultimately, God has to do his part. He said he would build his church, and my confidence in him that he's going to do that. And my job is to, okay, God, where do you need me laboring in your field of harvest? I'll do the best I can. And at the end of the day, I know you're going to build your church.
Yeah. You know, I'm thinking about the Sabbath principle as it applies to this situation. The Sabbath was not just simply a day off of work. It had more theological and spiritual implications than just
wasn't
a day off.
And an incredible expression of faith.
It's an incredible expression of faith. Because God's telling you, you know what? Stop working on the seventh because I'm going to give you enough on the sixth.
And some people didn't believe it at first.
No.
No, we got to wake up and go gather.
Go gather the manna. Go gather the manna. He's like, you know what? I'm going to make it rot.
Yeah.
Right?
See how good your efforts are on your own.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And so we overwork. We overgather, you know, not because we're trying to do things excellently, but we do it out of anxiety and out of fear. Maybe I'm not going to have enough for the seventh day when God says, I have already given you my word. And then he says, on top of that, not just once a week, I'm going to give you this. On the seventh year, you will not plant any seeds.
Amazing.
It's powerful.
Yeah.
You're not going to plant any seeds. You are going to let whatever's in the ground grow on its own. And from what already is there, you're going to have enough, not just for the seventh year, but also more than enough for the eighth year.
Absolutely.
And so this principle of, look, there is a moment in time where the works must cease. Mm-hmm. I have to stop striving to make everything happen. And I have to let go and say, you know what? I'm resting, not because necessarily it's just me resting, but I'm resting because I trust in God to fulfill my lacking.
Without a doubt.
I trust in God with my weakness. I trust in God with what I cannot do. And that is the system that God, I think, in principle, though we do not keep the Sabbath, right? We don't, you know, we're beyond the Sabbath. Hebrews chapter 4 is very clear on that. It says, Jesus is our Sabbath, and the Sabbath was simply a type of the kind of rest and trust we need to put on Jesus and things. The principle is there.
If I could interject this, and I agree with you 1,000%, you know, we can see a restating of every one of the Ten Commandments in the New Testament, except for the command to keep the Sabbath. Yeah. It's the only one. I was reading Wayne Cordero's book, and it actually is a part of my dissertation as well, one of the works that I cite. It's called Leading on Empty, and Wayne Cordero, he talks about the Sabbath, and it was very convicting to me. And he talked about the Sabbath as an act of faith, but there's this concept that hit me like a ton of bricks. If I don't take a day off, if I don't take a day of rest, then I'm actually trying to outdo God. Because even God works 6 days in creation.
Yes.
And on that seventh day, God said, it's time to rest. And if I don't follow that principle, then I'm trying to do more than God.
Right.
And so it really, that's what really, you know, got my attention to realize, like, this is a pattern of health that God has established from the beginning.
Yeah.
We work, we labor, and then we step back and we rest. Yeah. And we have our trust in God that he's going to bless what we've done.
Yeah, yeah. And it's not that God got tired and he rested, but he memorialized.
Exactly.
Stop doing the work. All the work has been done.
Yeah.
It's been done. It is finished.
And God established that principle.
Right.
You know, before the law, you know, I'm very strong that Christians are not bound by the law of Moses. And, and yet, this concept of Sabbath rest, as far as, you know, us having this confidence in God, I think it's healthy and I think it's right. And I think it could help a lot of pastors, you know, learn to disengage and have this confidence that, hey, this is God's church. He's got it.
Yeah.
Now, there is a work that I came across in my research, and it was about the solo pastor. And it's about how the majority of congregations, you know, are between 60 and 70 members. And they were looking at numbers across the board. But those numbers are very similar in the United Pentecostal Church as well. And I know that there are pastors that are looking at you and I and say, Brother Abrego, Brother Lopez, you guys go to a large ministry. You're part of a large church staff. Yeah. You've been involved. Your context is different from my context. And the reality is that the majority of pastors, sometimes they are the do-it-all, you know, in their church as their church is being established, as their church is growing, especially if they're, you know, like a church plant type situation. But, you know, I don't want to speak arrogantly to someone that, like, we just need to take a day off, you know, you need to rest. But the reality is that for everyone, no matter what your context is, ultimately it's God's responsibility to build his church.
Mm-hmm.
And so even pastors in that context, you're not everything to the church.
Mm-hmm.
You're not. And God never intended you to be. So don't pick up a weight that's not yours to carry.
Yeah. And, you know, and at the same time, Jesus was very clear that there are moments when the Sabbath is not followed. Even when they were under the law, he says, if your animal gets stuck in a pit, like, are you not going to take him out, right, on the Sabbath?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and his disciples picking of the wheat and working on the Sabbath, right? Look, you and I, we've gone through an intense season of doing our PhD, all right? There was much about that task where we had to violate the Sabbath. Come on, Lord have mercy. And then, you know, going on 3 hours of rest for multiple days at a time and having to deal with real situations, there are provisions. I mean, there are seasons, and it's very character forming. There are seasons where you're going to be very busy, and it is just a busy season, and you're not going to be able to rest. That's okay. That's okay. We don't want to be overly judgmental to individuals who are in seasons like that.
Sure,
it's like,
without
a doubt. Okay, well, this is what's required of me. Yes, it is. But it's God's will for you not to stay in that place. I think a lot of people who burn out have just learned to live on the adrenaline of busyness. And we have to defend ourselves from that. You know, it's the temptation to be busy all the time, or the guilt of being not busy.
Without a doubt.
Almost the guilt of not having anything to do.
We have to be productive all the time.
Yeah.
And rest. I'm a hypocrite in this area. You know, I made the comment earlier, I'm going to go to heaven tired, you know, that type of thing. But one of the things I've had to wrap my head around, and I haven't always done a good job of it, is that actually rest is productivity.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm resting and recovering, I'm being productive. That is allowing me to be more fruitful for God than if I were just to keep going 100 miles an hour, you know, 7 days a week, which I've had those seasons and you've had those seasons.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that this has been a wide-ranging conversation.
Yeah.
And there's so much, when we talk about health of leadership, there's so much to unpackage.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, one of the most encouraging things that I like to see, that I've seen, is when I see my leaders resting. You know, I know I have, you know, it's not hidden when our pastors, and particularly our pastor, Pastor Haney, he takes a vacation. That to me is not detrimental to the congregation.
Sure.
It is discipleship in and of itself, because when the congregation sees that even their spiritual leaders, the people who are trying to lead them and steward the congregation, when they see us resting, they say, okay, there is room for this. I can rest too. I can trust in God because I see it and I'm emulating what's happening
without
from our leadership. It is teaching the people you can trust in God.
Without a doubt.
Things. And so we've talked for a little while now, okay? Any last words or any last things that you want to share? We can continue on if you still have more time, but I know you're a busy guy.
I'm grateful for this conversation, and there is so much. There is so much, you know, especially like even in my research, your research, we are scratching the surface of some of these things. But what I love is that we're starting to have the conversation.
Yeah.
I was invited to a symposium at Urshan earlier this year, and they wanted me to address my research, talk to us about what you're discovering.
Right.
I'm so thankful that there are ears open now, and other researchers, other people are writing. I've come across other people in our fellowship that are writing about servant leadership. They're writing about, you know, pastoral leadership. Rodney Shaw has a great book on church administration. We're starting to deal with some of these things and say, what is our ecclesiology? How are we going to approach doing church? And so to all those voices, and Dr. Bernard, you know, I feel like he is... he's written about so many subjects, you know, from theology to practical church expression. I'm grateful for the voices that are willing to have these conversations, and at the same time, that we're not leaving our foundation of our core beliefs and who we are and our identity. I think we can move forward in academia, we can move forward in scholarship, and yet still be absolutely true to the core of our Pentecostal identity.
Yes, certainly so.